Oh, Fred, what have you done now?
Everything you've ever loved in a Bond film. More thrills, more excitement, more chills, and more. Roger Moore as James Bond 007 in Live and Let Die. You'll miss the most exciting Bond film of all. Live and Let Die.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Bond, James Bond, with your host, Mike Kalinowski, and myself, Brad Gilmore, promoting our brand new book, Bond, James Bond, exploring the shaken and stirred history of Ian Fleming's 007. This will be a limited podcast series that will dive into every single James Bond movie, and we will break them down. We will give our opinions, our hot takes, or whatever comes across our mind in the world of MI6's greatest secret agent, James Bond 007. We hope that you enjoy the podcast, so much so that you go to bondjamesbondbook.com and order our brand new book, available on bondjamesbondbook.com or wherever books are sold. Let's enjoy the podcast.
When you were young and your heart was an open book, you used to say, ever-changing world in which we live in makes you give in and cry. Say, live and let die.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Bond, James Bond, the podcast, the companion podcast to the book, Bond, James Bond, exploring the shaken and stirred history of Ian Fleming's 007. You can tell I've said that title a few times, Mike Kalinowski. I'm Brad Gilmore, joined by Mike Kalinowski.
Hello, sir. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever it is when you're watching this, listen to us.
Yes, there yes, of course, of course, of course. We are coming into a new era of the James Bond series.
Yes.
This is one that I'm really excited about because I will say, and we'll get into it. We'll get into it. But we're talking about Live and Let Die, 1973, the debut of Roger Moore as James Bond 007. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. This is the Bond you grew up with.
Roger Moore?
Roger Moore.
Yeah. I was going to say, it's like, these are the films that I have the personal connection. Like, all the Connery films, I never saw any of them in the theaters, except never seen any. Even then, I don't think I said Never Say Never Again in theaters. I think I watched that on VHS like years later. Yeah, I think even as a kid, I knew like this isn't James Bond.
You're right.
But these are the films I saw only two of Moore's in theaters. But then, of course, I went back and found them in VHS and had to watch them after that. Dog's trying to get up my lap.
That's all right.
But I do have my a connection to them. His earlier ones, and we'll talk with this one, and then Man with the Golden Gun, are so similar to me, I get them confused a lot. Like, especially before, when I was younger, I would get them very confused. Locales were similar. He looked the same. It wasn't until The Spy Who Loved Me, which really solidified, and that's where he really kind of came into his own in the role and kind of got out from Connery's shadow and what had happened. But these films, Moore will always have that special place to me. While not my favorite Bond, and we'll go into that later in the book, not for any reasons, but I do love him. I do. There's just something about Roger Moore in the role. Like you always say, you always remember your first. Moore was my first, so...
Yeah, it's so weird how that is, because you're just tied in forever to whoever's James Bond at the time. You love their movies, even if they're not great. And I will say, though, Live and Let Die is one of my favorite Bond movies. I love Live and Let Die. And I think because, again, it has all the elements that make a great James Bond movie. You have great title, great song, memorable villains, beautiful
women,
and you have the charm of Sir Roger Moore. Let's talk about him. Now, this is a guy who, this is when I first started to get into the Bond series and really research it, before we do in the book, just basic fan research, I was always surprised to find, or I was surprised to find that Roger Moore was older than Sean Connery when he took over the role. He was 45. When he took over for Sean Connery, who I believe was, 42 in Diamonds Are Forever, 41, something like that.
Wow, so he was really young when he started.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, and Moore never seemed 45 to me that you know, when he was in the role. He seemed very young looking.
Yeah, he looked very
the
vibrant.
Oldest to start.
Yeah, oldest to start and oldest to finish. He looked good, though. This was a really handsome Roger Moore. He's coming off of The Saint was the TV show that he was known for. And they could have gone a lot of different ways for replacing James Bond. Do you remember any of the other potential candidates during this time?
During this time, Dalton was kind of looked at.
Yes.
He was 25 at the time. And he had said, I'm too young. I can't do this. There's no way. He was real serious thespian at the time. And he was just like, I'm a kid. I don't have the experience to do Bond, but they had talked about Dalton that early on. He was always the big one in this time frame that stood out to me that I always remembered. And just seeing pictures of him, like they had some pictures from some theater he was doing. It's like, oh, he's a kid, like a baby he looked like. So yeah, but Moore was, and they liked, I think Moore tested, and it always seemed like when I was going movie to movie, there was the Eon and Cubby and them were always thinking of another Bond just in case they didn't work. Like Roger Moore was looked at back, you know, years prior to when Connery was in between, you know, wanting to come back and not. So, but you know, because The Saint and stuff like that. So he was always a top choice and a very different choice from Connery.
Here were some of the reported casting choices for Roger Moore for James Bond that Roger Moore would eventually get, but here's who was approached or screen tested for Live and Let Die. Some of these names are surprising. Some you probably have no idea who they are. Julian Glover, who actually ends up in For Your Eyes Only, John Gavin, Jeremy Brett, Simon Oates, John Ronan, William Gaunt, and the ones that you're going to definitely know, Adam West, famous for playing Batman.
Wow.
Burt Reynolds was offered the role. So was Adam West, but both turned it down because they thought that the actor should be British. So kudos to those gentlemen. And Michael Billington was offered the role. And even Albert R. Broccoli met with Sir Anthony Hopkins about playing James Bond, which I do not see. I do not see that at all. Anthony Hopkins, Bond villain. Bond villain. Yeah. And you know what? Anthony Hopkins was offered another Bond villain once we get... down the road, we'll talk about that. But I don't see him as James Bond, and they eventually landed on Roger Moore, which was obviously the perfect choice. I can't imagine Adam West has a European look to him, though. You know.
Yeah, I don't know if I can. Yeah, that's tough. It's tough when someone's in the role and that you love them so much. You're kind of like, yeah, I can't see anyone else.
Yeah, but they landed on Roger Moore, and then. This was Live and Let Die. I think that the plot was, again, Bond likes to copy whatever is popular at the time. And at the time, very popular thing was blaxploitation films in the 1970s. That's where stars like Rudy Ray Moore, when Dolomite came out, Pam Grier was in a lot of movies at this time in the 1970s, very popular. And they were trying to capitalize off the popularity of those in 1973. Yeah. And the plot takes place in Harlem and in New Orleans. And has to do with kind of voodoo and
supernatural-ish.
What was the name of the island? San Monique or something like, or what was that?
I believe so.
San Monique. And it's somewhat of another one of those plots where it's like, I'm not sure what the bad guy's trying to do.
I remember you got Kananga, but it's Mr. Big.
Mm-hmm.
And watching him, I'm like, what's wrong with his face? Like, you don't think about it. You're like, but why? Something's off on this dude. What is going on here? And then it's later revealed, it was a mask and stuff, and he was the same guy. But this movie to me, like the plot, doesn't stick with me. I remember bits and pieces. I remember the funeral in New Orleans where they kill that guy and they bring the coffin over his body and lift him up. And that was awesome.
Whose funeral? Yours.
Just awesome. So that was cool. I remember, of course, the alligator scene.
Yeah, with Teehee.
Yeah, and I was watching that recently with my girlfriend, and she had never seen it. And she's like, wait a minute, that guy really did that? So I had to go back, and I showed her, they have online the behind the scenes of the mm-hmm. of the guy who owned that farm, and he did it. And she's like, there was no rope on him? I was like, no, he just ran. He ran over those damn
just things. Did it. And I think there's an outtake where you can see he actually falls.
We fell. He took a tumble in there.
Yeah.
Like that. And then, the cool, not the cool thing, but the fascinating thing about this is I remember, the capsule he sticks in the guy's mouth at the end to explode, but how much Yaphet Kotto just hated all that. And you understand his reasoning why in the making of this film. There's a lot of behind the scenes, especially Bond being so on the forefront of, casting a black man in the lead role and Bond having a relationship with a black woman at the mm-hmm. time, where they were always very forward thinking. But the world wasn't. And a lot of times, they were not invited to the press screenings of the so premiere. Crazy. And Rosie, what's her name? Rosie Carter? Rosie, Gloria Hendry.
Mm-hmm.
Her character was supposed to be really small, and they loved her in the role, so they kind of made it bigger. But a lot of kind of cultural things behind the scenes and happened with this film, which was really kind of fascinating.
Yeah, and a thing that everyone should go out and read: Roger Moore kept a diary during the filming of this movie.
Yes,
and published
that thing is
it.
Great.
It is such an interesting read. I mean, he even goes on about the Kennedy assassination and stuff in it. It's a really, really fascinating read. But you're right; there was some trepidation about Rosie Carver's character, played by Gloria Hendry, Bond being in this. A relationship with a black woman, even like you said, a leading Bond villain of color, as Kananga and Mr. Big. And again, when you're watching this as a kid, and I know probably the podcast fans are sick of us saying as a kid when you watch it as a kid, but that's where you first see these movies.
And you don't think about it like that.
You don't think about any of that. Like you don't think about the taboo-ness of an interracial on-screen relationship in 1971. Or 1973, excuse me, 1973.
Yeah,
you don't think about it.
Nope. Yeah, it's just it's Bond with a girl. And that's the scene where he's got the hairspray with the cigarette lighter on the snake and then Teehee with that clamping arm thing.
Wait a minute. Can we talk about Teehee for 1 second? The worst fake hand ever. If you see the movie, you can see he's obviously holding a claw. He's obviously holding it because his wrist is this big.
And then made his suit jacket 7 inches longer. Why, Mr. Bong?
I mean, I like the idea of the hand. I like the idea, but so silly. I believe Gloria Hendry wasn't she a playmate or something? Or she worked in the Playboy Club? Or
I wouldn't doubt that.
She's a very beautiful woman. Model. Da, 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 da. I'm trying to see if there's something in there about her being in. I thought she was in Playboy, and I don't know why I thought that. Maybe I'm wrong.
There's a lot of girls that were in Playboy.
Oh yeah, she worked
on women.
She worked as a Playboy bunny at the New York Playboy Club from 1965 till 1972. First African American woman to be romantically linked with James Bond 007. Okay, yes. So she is, I guess, the first or one of the first Bond girls of color. We've seen Asian women before. And I think that's the only other race outside of, European or white
Yeah, white European women.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much been Bond's style for the majority of the movies. But speaking of white European women, Jane Seymour is breathtaking in this movie. This is her first film ever. Mm-hmm. She plays Solitaire. Now, in the book, Solitaire was a black woman as well. I think that they were like, I think that I remember reading they didn't want to have two black women as the main Bond women, if I remember my reading. So they decided to change the ethnicity of Solitaire and make her European, English.
Yeah.
And they went with Jane Seymour. And I love the character of Solitaire because she's so innocent. You actually you believe her performance. She seems like this real life. I'm a psychic who reads these tarot cards. She truly, as Roger Moore says, you do believe in the cards, right? And she believes in those cards. And I love her in this role.
Yeah. And it's great to see just her so young and different. Like I knew her much, I of course knew her as an actress before as I'm older, but then going back and watching these and there's just this innocence about her. And that one's like her face when she sees that Moore's been touching the cards and stuff. It's just like sacrilege to her.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely. He's sitting there, he's got her like cloak on. He's sitting in that chair. Roger Moore was such the king. I know people like to clown on him because he was goofy, but that man, we'll get into him in some of the later films, his deadpan reactions and deadpan delivery on so much of this dialogue just kills. It's just awesome.
He is very good at this. Let's talk about, I wanted to ask you this. Was this the first time, because this is the eighth James Bond movie.
Okay.
Is this the first time we see James Bond's apartment or house?
I believe it was because I wanted to talk about this last time, but like the things that they tried to do between him and Connery, they had to separate them. Like he doesn't wear a fedora, was it a Trilby?
Yeah.
The type of hat, like he doesn't wear one of those. He smokes a cigar, not a cigarette.
Mm-hmm.
That was his thing. He had those little cigars and he didn't do martinis. I want to say he drank brandy.
Yeah, he never did.
It's in the book. There was a couple of listed things that they were like, okay, we've got to separate him from Connery. The big thing for me, and I didn't realize at the time, was like, he never smoked a cigarette. He was a cigar guy.
Yeah, that is interesting.
Cigars.
Dress also, the way he dressed was very different than Sean Connery. Yeah. Sean Connery was very like, I'm going to wear a gray suit, and that's pretty much, or a black suit, and that's all you're ever going to see me in. Roger Moore was way more colorful.
You know, it's funny. I want to say it's yellow. He's in his apartment and he's a robe on, doesn't he? Like a short robe?
Yes.
Connery, four films prior is in a blue terry cloth and we're laughing about him. Here's Moore in a robe, a yellow robe walking around his house and we don't even think about it. Like, whatever. It was weird. Maybe it's just the times and we knew and they're different Bonds and Connery just kind of stuck out with wearing that outfit.
You want to talk about sticking
Moore
out.
Moore would probably look right at home in that thing.
The thing that stuck out about James Bond's flat or his apartment or wherever we are, his home, is he has these bronze roosters in his kitchen.
What?
Yes, on the wall, there are these roosters. And it's always stuck out to me my whole life. And I'm always like, that's like the least James Bondy thing ever.
You think about it, like, why would we want to see his apartment? Like, we don't – like I think the Craig films nailed it. Like just sparse, nothing there, some piece of furniture, some little thing of art here or there. That would be like – you don't ever think about him having a home. And this one was like he was like Holly Homemaker with this home that he had.
Yeah.
And so it was like, okay.
He had the – I think it was a cappuccino machine or espresso machine. It was cappuccino or espresso. I don't drink coffee, so I don't really know the difference. But I just remember after he like makes M a cup and M goes, is that all it does?
Yeah.
And then there's a great though scene during the opening where Bond has the watch that's magnetic.
Yeah.
Right. And he's making out with the Italian, I think she's a spy of some kind or Italian government worker that they're looking for. And M's like, have you seen her, James? And Moneypenny, who normally is the jealous type and wants to be in the relationship with Bond, helps Bond. He hides her in the closet, or she hides the agent in the closet.
Right.
And then gets M's coat for him and says, okay, James, bye. And then James is making out with her, and he turns a little his watch on, the magnetic watch, and he just goes down the back of the dress and unzips her her dress.
She is not in here, even listed in the credits, except for there's beautiful girl, Madeline Smith. So I'm assuming that's her.
I'm going to go with that. Yes, Madeline Smith, beautiful girl, an Italian agent who Bond briefly romances at the beginning of the film. Yeah, very pretty girl. Very, very pretty girl.
Yeah, different kind of Moneypenny thing. But again, maybe that's another change that they were trying to do, because she'd been pining for him for so long. And then that last scene in on Her Majesty's Secret Service, when he drives off and they're married and she's kind of there by herself. And I don't remember too much of her from Diamonds Are Forever. So
there's just the one scene. I think we talked about it in a behind the scenes, but she's
so
in
this
the
one. Maybe that was with
for a second.
That's right. So maybe with this one, they said, all right, we got to deal with their dynamic a little differently. They're two different Bonds. Let's change the dynamic a little bit. And theirs was much more of that playful flirting.
But Lois Maxwell's still in the role, by the way. So is Bernard Lee as M. Desmond Llewellyn not in this movie. We don't see him in Live and Let Die.
I wonder why that was.
I don't know, but we're this far into it, though, and we haven't talked about Baron Sambetti.
Like, there's three different. So you've got Mr. Big, Kananga, Teehee, and now Samedi. Like, and I'll be honest, creepy as hell, but all I ever knew him from was the 7-Up guy.
That's what everybody says.
Yeah. Never had 7-Up, never had it, never will. He had that voice. Like, that's when I grew up with him. He was the 7-Up dude. And I didn't put it together when I watched the movie, but that, it was like, he didn't seem like. Like, he's got that scene, he's like, with the snakes dancing, which is creepy.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end of the train, which again was creepy, but it's like, what was his whole deal?
I don't know.
Like,
just
as a kid, like, what?
He was a voodoo master.
They needed a voodoo guy in there. I'm like, okay.
So they got Jeffrey Holder, and he also choreographed the movie, which I found interesting. He was the choreographer for any of the dance numbers. But he is the 7-Up man. I think just he has a classic look as a villain. Baron Sambetti does. He was, just great look.
I had a great time with him playing GoldenEye 64.
Yes.
Baron Sambetti, he was fantastic in that game. I loved playing with him.
Yes, yes.
So it just shows to show you that was like 20 years later, and he's in a video game. He's one of the most popular characters in it. So
he definitely made his mark.
Yeah, that's the thing with Bond villains too. You can have such limited screen time, but make such an indelible mark on fandom and the culture of Bond. It just, because they're so memorable. It's like that scene of him with that face painted on the train, and it's just leaving, you know, it's back, and he's on it, sitting on the back of a train. So
very, very memorable. Also, this is the first of two appearances by Chef J.W. Pepper.
What'd you say, boy?
J.W. Pepper.
Mr. Pepper.
Look, I'm from the South, as you know. I'm from Texas. Louisiana is our next door neighbor. There are people that sound
Texas,
like that.
Texas South, Louisiana South, though, are two different things.
Yes, there's a Cajun
there's
South.
Two different things.
Yeah, there's a Cajun South, and then there's a South Texas slang. But I will be honest with you. This is such an exaggeration of a Southern sheriff, even at the time.
He's like dip too. He's like, oh boy, I'm going to get you, boy. I want to say, I'm looking it up right now, because I believe he played, he did. He played the same exact role in Superman 2.
Yes.
He wasn't Sheriff Pepper. He could have been if they were in the same city, but same state. But so he played that. This guy had the typecast down for obnoxious sheriffs.
Yes.
What you do, boy? Get out this car. Arrest that man, boy.
That's exactly who he was. And it's funny that his description in the sides was an uncouth Southern sheriff, which he definitely lives up to. Clifton James is his name. He's actually from Spokane, Washington, believe it or not.
Right now,
he died a couple years ago at the age of 96.
Yeah. He died a couple years ago? A
couple years ago. Yeah.
Like, that's one of those things. Okay. So people every day, you know, Twitter, so-and-so actor passed away, this and that. I'm like, who? But like him, like that, I don't even remember when that happened. Like, you would think you're kind of an adult. Maybe it's just because we're in kind of in this world of Bond, and but
yeah, he died in April of 2017. So about four and a half years ago. So not too far.
I can't believe I didn't think about that or didn't you hear about that.
Yeah, not too far along. But 96, what a great run. What a great life.
Yeah, it's a great run.
Let me ask you this.
Ask away.
When you talked about it earlier, Bond's in the cloak of solitaire.
Yeah.
And he says, well, you truly believe in the cards, right? She goes, well, they have never lied to me before. And he goes, pick one, right? And she picks the card and she turns it over. It's the lovers.
Lovers.
Right? Yeah. And then they start to kiss or whatever, and Bond throws the card deck behind him, and you see they're all the lovers. Because he went into a tarot card shop earlier in the movie. He was planning ahead, and he also, I guess, wanted to see what the upside-down Queen of Cups meant, and that was meant a female who's going to betray you or whatever. And so he does that, and he beds solitaire.
Yeah.
She then loses her powers. Now, when I actually literally rewatched this movie maybe a week ago, I always thought that was really cold and callous and mean of Bond, knowingly taking this woman's power away from her, right?
Yeah.
But, well, let me ask you this. What did you think of that?
It seemed very, like, I mean, he's Bond. He's a killer. Like, I don't, like, whatever to accomplish the mission. Like, and now, is there a scene, because you watched it more recently than I did, is there a scene where Kananga makes her choose the card and she's like, she's never wrong. You know, your life depends on this, or her life depends on this, of what this card is going to be.
Well, so there's a couple things. One, she sees the lovers, right? She turns over the lovers, and then she goes, what is it? She goes, death. It's death, right?
Yeah.
And she lies to him. And then there's the scene where there's she has to reach into the pots or whatever.
That's what it is. Okay.
And there's
it isn't like
snake
and water. Someone they pull the fool card, or is that a scene like where before that where they're thinking about that Bond was
with
the fool?
That was with Bond. Yeah, he reveals the fool or what have you.
Yeah.
So what I forgot though in the movie is she's laying in bed on her side and she's obviously very shaken that her powers are no longer there, and it's actually kind of sweet because Roger Moore, I think, thought. Or Roger Moore's Bond thought, she doesn't really have a power. She's just reading these cards, right? Yeah. And then he realizes, because he's like, darling, I do have to admit something. Like, hey, you know, I kind of, he says, the deck was slightly stacked in my favor, is what he says. And she goes, it doesn't matter now. I don't have this power anymore. And he actually seems a little bit bothered that he did that to her. Yeah. He does seem bothered, which I think is the right tone to hit. Even back then, is you took this woman's power away, you unknowingly took it away, though, and he felt bad about it.
There's a lot when we'll get into more over his films, like what his Bond was and what he wanted with. And a lot of times he would fight against the violence that they wanted for Bond, especially in Free Rise Only. We'll talk a lot about, like, he realized these movies were for a little bit younger audiences, too, sometimes, and tried to. And that's why he kind of leaned into the comedy a lot more. But his Bond, he's trying to make a softer Bond. And that's a great, within character, I think, a great moment for him.
Again, this is a Mankiewicz script. And even like what we talked about, how they said they didn't want two black women as the Bond women. And it's, again, that's a sign of the times. And it is what it is, right? Had that decision wouldn't be made today. Obviously, they would just go for it. If that's what they were going to do, that's what they're going to do. But Mankiewicz, it is the 70s, but I don't think that he ever hung around or spoke to or went to any of the locations in which he was depicting in the movie, because the way that the people talk in this film, and I'm saying everybody in America especially, but especially in Harlem and New Orleans, is so top surface level. This is what I think. Even Felix Leiter goes, I need an APB on a pimp mobile. And at one point, and then Mr. Big, Bond says, my name's Bond, James Bond. He goes, names are for tombstones, daddy, right? And stuff like that. It's like, go now, take him out to the back and waste this honky. It's like, who talks like that? Nobody talks like that.
No, and you get, you know, like you made a good point, like the blaxploitation films at the time were in cinemas and that was, you know, Superfly and all this stuff. Yeah. That's what they were kind of leaned into. And it was the voice of what was going on. And again, it was set in America. I love, there's a great, it's in the James Bond archive book. There's a great, great shot of Moore on set in Harlem and just this just destroyed, dilapidated city that like mm-hmm. they'd said is like, you know, we had to film there. We had to watch out, you know, people are throwing crap from the balconies down on us and they didn't want us there. And it just, it really gave a look at New York in this time. And it was just fascinating to look at.
Last thing on this one. Last, the filet of soul, of course. Names of his tombstones, daddy. Now go outside and waste this honky. It just stuck out to me so
much. Outside, waste this honky.
Waste him. Again, you know, is what it is. It's a sign of the times. The song.
Yeah.
The song, Paul McCartney and Wings, Live and Let Die. Again, they said that they brought the song to him, and Albert Broccoli goes, well, who's going to sing it? And they're like, it's Paul McCartney. What do you mean?
Paul McCartney's going to sing it.
He's going to sing the song. What do you think of this song?
This, what do I think?
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is one of the all-time, not even just most popular Bond songs, just, and it's so weird because, like, this is the one probably over all films that I can separate from Bond. And it's just a great song. Does it make any sense?
Mm-hmm.
Like all these songs that we love and I love are so intrinsic to the film itself. This song transcends the film, I think. And I don't know if it's because I don't think it's a great film, but I can listen to it on the radio. And I think of Bond, but I also think of just great music. Where every other time, if I hear Goldfinger on the radio, it's Bond.
Mm-hmm.
There's no question about it. If I hear Skyfall on the radio, it's Bond.
Mm-hmm.
This song, I can, and it plays so much out. You know, a lot of these Bond songs don't play on the radio as much,
mm-hmm.
but Live and Let Die is always on the radio somewhere.
Live and Let Die, View to a Kill,
View to a Kill, yeah.
And for me, The Spy Who Loved Me, those I think are songs that people know that they don't, like you said, tie in directly to Bond. Like they, like if a layman heard Dance Into the Fire, they're not gonna think James Bond off no. top. Live and Let Die, not either. For me, Carly Simon's Nobody Does It Better. I don't think you think of Bond immediately. Maybe you do. I don't know.
I would say, I mean, I love it, but it's tied to Bond is Louis Armstrong's We Have All the Time in the World. But that's, you know, I'm trying to think what else. Maybe Rita Coolidge's All Time High.
All Time High is one.
Doesn't tie necessarily to the film so much, but like so many of the other ones do.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, this one just kind of transcends it.
It's just so good. It's just so damn good. Again, this song is perfect.
Yes, sir.
In every way. Let's look at some of the trivia. Now, this is something that I found that I don't, when I was researching, when you were researching, even when I read up on a lot of stuff, I never heard this before. And tell me if you remember this.
Okay.
Do you remember them approaching Sean Connery to do this movie?
I don't.
So I never heard that either.
Like you said, the research, like it was always one and done with Diamonds Are Forever. That's from the people that I had, interviews I'd read, the behind the scenes stuff. It seemed like, you're coming back for $1 million. You're going to get producer credit, screen. You're going to get casting approval. You're going to get editing, you know, the cut approval. We're going to let you do other films for us. You know, we're going to get back your other films. Like that seemed like, I don't remember him thinking he's coming back.
No. So, but this is a trivia fact on IMDb. So I've never heard this before, but this is a first for me. Sean Connery was reported to turn down an astronomical sum of $5.5 million, which would be $32 million in today's dollars, to play James Bond for a seventh time. Connery gave Moore his personal seal of approval for inheriting the role, calling him an ideal Bond. Now, I've heard Connery say that before about Roger Moore, but I never heard of him being offered this movie for $5.5 million.
I never heard that.
I don't think it's true because the budget was $7 million.
Yeah, and the thing with IMDb trivia, like I like to use it and link it and talk about it. If it's like I've heard it, like when I went through this book and I would always check the trivia page and I was trying to, you know, think of facts to back up story because, you know, you want to kind of source check everything that's not from like the official Bond canon, people that are involved with EM Productions. If it showed up two or three different places, I'm like, okay, that's probably true. But if it's just on IMDb by itself, I'm kind of like, I don't know about that. So it's got to come from somewhere. You know, that's just a weird rumor. Like, why would someone go, like, yeah, he did it for $5 million, but that sounds ridiculous.
It doesn't sound right.
You can't make a movie for $2 million. You got a $7 million budget. Five of it's going to your star. You ain't making that movie.
No.
I don't know.
Not even 1973. Yeah. Anyway, Roger Moore is 45 when he made his debut as Bond. He's the oldest actor to portray the character. And we've already talked about this. He wrote a book called James Bond 007, Live and Let Die. Published as a paperback and is considered quite rare today if you can find a copy. But again, if you haven't read that, it is an insane.
Is it rare?
That's what they say.
I want to say I saw it on Amazon. Like I was thinking about getting it.
Oh, okay.
But I was going to get it, but I think I didn't want to be influenced by anything he wrote in our book. I didn't want to, you know, regurgitate just facts that he covered an entire book on. Like we said, like it's so tough doing a book on a film series when, you know, there's entire books devoted to one movie.
Yeah. No, I'm with you. But those are some of the behind the scenes details of Live and Let Die. So we come to the final segment of the show. Mr. Kalinowski.
Favorite time. Here we go.
Mr. Kalinowski, what do we have on this one? It is 1973's James Bond, Live and Let Die. What do you think this movie?
64 was Diamonds Are Forever.
64 62 is a 64.
So it was a 64. I believe this film is looked at higher than that.
Okay.
I think it's more reviewed. I know people like more in the role. I'm taking into factors everything that I've missed so far on all of these. And I'm going to say this struck, because they went higher on the next couple ones. I'm going to say this is a 74%.
A 74%, you say,
I say
65% it was given. Damn. While not one of the highest rated Bond films, Live and Let Die finds Roger Moore adding his stamp to the series with flashes of style and an improved sense of humor. Only 64% on this
1%
one.
Or 65. From the last one.
65. I'm sorry, 65%.
65. So it went up
2%.
2%.
Mm-hmm. Not a resounding.
Not bad. I mean, better than your previous film. You always want to do better than your previous film.
But it's no Dr. No, which was 90. What did we say? 95.
95. The highest so far, I think, was
99.
Diamonds Are Forever.
Goldfinger.
Goldfinger. 99.
Yeah, Goldfinger had a 99. Yeah. So there you go. Roger Moore. Can he find his footing in the next James Bond film, The Man with the Golden Gun? We will find out. Mike, the people can find you and follow you at Mike Kalinowski. Is that correct?
You can find me at Mike Kalinowski. That's right, buddy.
And
simple.
You can find me at Brad Gilmore. We're going to be talking about The Man with the Golden Gun, Roger Moore's follow-up, and the second of his seventh James Bond movies on the next episode of the show. Go to BondJamesBondBook.com to order the book right now, and we'll be back with the next episode.
Let's do it.
Oh, Brad, what have you done now?